I don't think after this office I'm ever going to be able to speak in public again. They've ruined it for me, Darwin. Next time they're going to get you, so watch out. Now, there, by this time in the weekend and this time in your lives, there certainly is no introduction needed to this man, but I would like to say that over the years in my life with Baba, Darwin has been someone who has always symbolized to me that life lived that Baba asked us to live. What I mean by that is that he has stayed true to his work in the world, to the occupation, to the family, to the things that Baba gave him. He stayed true to them, but always, always put Baba first and did everything for Baba, so that his life, ordinary life in the world, family life, occupation, became extraordinary, is extraordinary, not because of Darwin Shaw, but because of Meher Baba. And you know, every time I hear Darwin talk, and probably you also share this, it strikes me that Darwin points to Baba's divinity and to his glory, not because Darwin Shaw is a great man, or because Darwin Shaw is this and that, or says that thing or this thing, but because Darwin Shaw has learned the true art of living with Baba. He's learned how to get out of the way and to let beloved Baba come through, not just in his talks, but in his life. And so not for years and years from now, people will remember Darwin's sharing of Baba because he lived it. And when we sit and listen to him and we then feel Baba's presence, we know what it is to meet with Meher Baba in this spirit, because he just gets out of the way and lets Baba be here with us. And we are very privileged to have had so much time with him and hearing Darwin and sharing his experiences. Baba has given us a great gift, as you all know. And so from my heart, I give you Darwin Shaw.
Thank you, Charles. Thank you, too. Thank you. Yeah, I don't know how I'm going to live up to that. Wow. Well, let me start with, I have a lot of notes here. We'll probably be here all night. But this is just to counteract some of the prophets of doom. A little quote from Baba, which he gave in 1947, which was, "The world is approaching a glorious dawn once again in its inevitable course of ups and downs." That's it. Under the title of the talk, The Preparation and the Gift, it's such an expansive subject, and it seemed easy enough when I conjured up the title, but the more I thought of it, the more complicated it became, because I realized that to prepare is something that we have to do and that Baba has to do within us, mostly what Baba has to do within us. But we do have to try, and since we're different in many ways, there are many things which we all share in common, but we have different samskaras, different combinations of them, and different ways of practicing some kind of discipline and directing our energies and our aspirations. And so it's sort of an individual thing of how we will prepare. Of course, Baba has given us some superb guidelines, and one of the best ones that Charles inferred was that my way is the way of self-effacement. And he said that this is really not a way of weakness, but a way of strength, and that through it we would grow strong in Baba's love. Bless you. Did it on purpose. And I know that one could listen to a long talk and a great many points could be brought out, but generally when you go away from a talk, when many things are discussed, you're lucky if one thing will stand out in your mind that you'll be able to hold on to and that will be just outstandingly important to you. And I hope that in connection with the preparation, that one thing can be summed up in one word, which is longing. I hope you will remember that one word, longing. It is probably far more important than any of us realize. I'm sure I didn't realize it through the years, like between 1934 and 1952, when we were longing for Baba so much and didn't get to see him. We were making the grade, but we certainly didn't have enough money to go to India, and no way we could make it. But some of us would like to sit around and cook up wild ideas of how we get to Europe and get a car over there and drive all the way across Europe and somehow we get to where Baba was. it kind of helped us to, you know, fantasize. But nevertheless, Baba was working with us more than we realized through those years. There were years of longing, love longing, years of suffering the pangs of separation and feeling so much deep longing within. And sometimes it would be so intense that one would think it would hurt one's heart. But still, it seemed to be the thing that one had to do. It wasn't imposed as a discipline. It was just something that came natural after seeing Baba and having hopes of seeing him again. One could not help but long. Baba has stressed this. You'd be surprised, perhaps not, but I think you might, to discover how many times throughout the writings that have become available that Baba has pointed to and emphasized the importance of longing. Heart's longing for the beloved. I know at least one person who did get to see Baba in the final days, well, a few years before he dropped his body, and this was the one word he brought back. Longing. To spread that word about longing, the importance of longing for the beloved. Of course, there are other things involved. We do have to exercise a discipline. Although grace is something that is freely given, well, it's like a mother washing a little child's hands and clothes. She does wash them again and again, but she hopes that after a while the child will kind of give up playing in the mud. You know, learn to keep his clothes dry. Baba once described himself as the universal laundryman. He did, yeah. He comes to launder our souls and purify them, and only he can really do it. But we help him in his work when we try. And he gives us impossible things to do, but they're not really impossible because he gives them to us and he tells us in the face of the difficult prospect, try, just try and I will help you. So rather than say, oh gosh, I couldn't do that. I mean, does he realize I couldn't do that? You know, try. See? So, and these involve some of the many very deep-seated things which we think are normal and everybody else is doing these things and we shouldn't be expected to be different than anyone else. But we have to remember that we are spiritual aspirants and we're trying to live the life of an aspirant, not the life of the worldly person. And Baba wants to free us from the gross level, and from all false levels. And it is his work, but we have to strive to rise to the occasion of his effort with us. Perhaps it's difficult for us to realize that this infinite being even knows where we are, who we are in our tiny corners of the world, but he does. I recall a story told to me by Jeff Wolverton one time. Many of you know Jeff. He works at the center over in Myrtle Beach. And some years before he came east and then south to the center, he and some others he knew, a couple of fellows, used to like to go to like a Greasy Spoon coffee house and sit there and put a picture of Baba on the table and drink coffee and just talk about Baba, you know. And this one occasion, there were three of them sitting there, and there was an empty chair there, and they were talking about Baba. And all of a sudden, they discovered that Baba was sitting in the empty chair. They saw him. You see? How did he know where they were in that little tiny old coffee house in Seattle? See? Your love draws him. Loving him is, of course, the main drawing card. That drew him to America several times, and it will draw him into your heart and more into your life. This is, of course, the love-longing, love and longing. These are the main things. Getting into my talk, I want to weave in stories and things, and here's one that I came across. I'd forgotten I'd even had this notebook. And just before coming out here, I was rummaging around, and I came across this. And I said, I'm meant to share this with the people out west. And this is an event that took place at... I could tell you about it, but the way it's written, it's better than I could tell you extemporaneously. This was on Tuesday, May 27th, 1958, at the barn in Myrtle Beach. In the afternoon, Baba attended the men's show in the barn. It was so funny, and Baba laughed so much that he said that, until now, I have not laughed so much in this incarnation. He said that his face hurt from laughing so much. Actually, it was so hilarious, the program they put on. And Baba almost broke his silence, it seemed. He had to hold a handkerchief over his face to keep from laughing. At the end of the show, when Baba was about to leave, the orchestral group, some of the members there, composed a little orchestra, and they began to softly play Begin the Begin. This seemed to strike a mood of great depth and devotion. Baba just sat there and seemed to go deeper into the mood. He seemed to be intensely with us, and yet withdrawn to a deeper than usual level. He looked around at the faces of his lovers, who stood silently around him, some perhaps inwardly repeating the eternal pledge of love so beautifully expressed in the words of Begin the Begin. Baba shifted from the chair in which he had been sitting to the carrying chair. He was about to give the signal for the boys to pick up the chair and depart, but held back and seemed engrossed in work. The mood deepened, and everyone stood silently by, feeling greater love and reverence for beloved. Finally, Baba gave the signal and was carried out to the car. But even after getting to the car, he remained seated in the carrying chair working. After a while, he stood up and moved to the car. And then someone brought a large turtle, which was crawling nearby, and brought it over for Baba to see. As the car was getting ready to leave, Beloved's hand rested on the top of the door, and several, including D.S., stooped reverently to kiss that sacred hand, the hand of Christ. When Baba reached the lagoon cabin, he got out of the car, but instead of going into the cabin, he went to a chair in the shade and sat down. He was soon completely absorbed in work. He seemed abstract. The mood was profound. The group approached quietly, one by one, and watched from a distance. Baba stayed there and continued to work. Adi and Erich stood near him. Erich held the umbrella over Beloved's head to protect it from the sun. Everyone standing around was struck with wonder when seeing Baba thus. The atmosphere became surcharged with indefinable significance. One woman broke from the waiting group and, sobbing, tried to get to Baba, but she was restrained. Baba continued working for quite a while. Several times he seemed about to get up, but then eased back into the chair to continue his working. Finally, Beloved did arise from the chair and, leaning on Erich's arm, slowly made his way to the car. DS opened the car door and was awestruck by the look in Baba's eyes. Baba truly seemed to be the Omnipotent One, the Eternal Being, and DS silently exclaimed as he looked into those two fathomless pools of infinity, "Thou art the eternal ocean of the infinite being." That was written at that time. Well, now, in connection with the preparation and the gift, like in my case, and I hope you will all feel that you are participating in these things that I've talked about this evening, I'm sure that Baba would want you to feel that way. In 1952, when Baba came to America, at the center, one day he called John Bass and myself into the lagoon cabin and asked us if we could get free for about 3 weeks to be with him every day in New York City. "Live with me," he said, "and live with Baba." And of course we said, "Of course we can, Baba. How will you do it?" And we replied that we had saved up vacation time and we could manage it. And so we had this prospect to look forward to. And I must say that this was something, you know, that I've been dreaming about all through those years up to 1952, of being more intimately with Baba. And so, actually, we had no idea that Baba would have to undergo that terrible accident in Prague, Oklahoma, on the 24th of May, which was a great shock to all of us, and we were just indescribably distressed by all of this. But of course, you must have read all about it and how Baba came through it all and shedding his blood on our soil was part of his work for us and, of course, for the world. And so he recuperated in Yupan Dunes back in Myrtle Beach and finally came up to New York in mid-July. And in the meantime, Phyllis had been working desperately to find a place for Baba and his group to stay, and finally was lucky enough to get a place in Scarsdale, about 35 miles north of New York City, the home of Kate Ferris. And she actually gracefully vacated the whole building so that Baba and all the women who were with him, you know, Mara, Mani, Maru, Rano, Kitty, and Elizabeth, who was also recuperating from injuries, broken arms from the accident. And Keith McGaffey, Phyllis's cousin, a young boy of 16 or 17, was there too to do night duty for Bob and also to help out through the day. And actually, John Bass and I did not stay nights during that period of time. Fred and Ella Winterfeld offered me the hospitality of their home in New York City, and I had my own car. And during all that time, having read so much about what is required of those here near Baba, I tried to conform to that pattern as much as I could. I would get up at 4 o'clock every morning and shower and shave and actually, if you pardon me saying it, take an enema so that I'd be free for the day and I wouldn't have to, you know, excuse myself at an opportune time and drive out to be with Baba. And this happened every day, and so that I could be completely at his service. And one of the first things that Baba warned John and I about, and also Keith, was that we must not look at Mara, Mani, and Maru. They were off limits. And maybe don't think that didn't lead into some interesting situations, because we were around them all the time. We could be in the house and move around, and actually with Charmaine Deuce in her car and in my car, we were driving them into the city in different places almost, well, quite frequently, not every day, but quite frequently. And we could look at the women's feet and see their saris, but enough to look away and not look up at their faces. But sometimes that did happen in spite of everything. I recall one time I had been in the basement apartment where Keith McGaffey stayed, and the word called came for me to come up. Baba wanted me. And so when I came in the room, there was Maru with a tray of fruit standing there, and I looked, you know, couldn't help seeing her. I turned around and wheeled her back out until she finally left. But Baba, of course, made nothing of it. He realized that maybe it was a test, I don't know, but I didn't stay and, you know, stare at her at all. At other times, sometimes I recall one time at the Bronx Zoo that Mara and Mani and Maru and I guess Phyllis and Adele were there too. But they had gone ahead of us and gone down a little lined alley, a little cul-de-sac, and as we were wheeling Baba along, they were coming back, and it happened so suddenly, we almost ran into each other. Little things like that would take place. And generally, when we would go to the city from Scarsdale, Baba would ride with Mehran Mani and Maru in Charmaine Deuce's car, and that would precede my car with Dr. Goar and Keith and whoever else was going along. And Baba would occupy the whole back seat because of his leg being in a cast, you know, and his left arm in a sling. And he would look out almost all the way, and he'd be waving to us in the car coming from the back. And I recall different incidences there, where one occasion was when we took Baba to the dentist in New York City. And on this occasion, actually, it was Energy, or Marion Florsheim, who had taken Baba in her car, and I followed in my car with the wheelchair and all of that. And we got Baba into the dentist's office. And meantime, Energy had gone off to park her car, and I waited for Baba. And she came out with Baba, and then had to go to get her car, but that left me alone with Baba in the vestibule of the building where Baba had gone to the dentist. And here we were, all alone, no one to read Baba's board. I don't think he even had it with him. And actually Baba had on something white, and it looked as though he might have been a patient rather than an Indian, you know, with his leg like that. And so we sat there a while, and I must say that I felt completely at ease with Baba. We seemed to feel completely at ease, you know, just relaxed. And but we waited a while, and Energy didn't make it back, I suppose, having trouble getting the car. So Baba motioned, "Let's go outside." So I wheeled him outside, and we looked around, didn't see him, so Baba said, "Let's go up the street." So here I am, wheeling the avatar up the street, people walking by, looking, you know, not paying any attention, and I'm looking at them, and I, you know, it's just about blowing my mind if I had any idea who it was, you know. Here he is, and Baba himself, just as casual as can be, you know, not making anything of it. But I contrast that with an experience I had with Baba in 1954. One day, Baba led us down the hill from Upper Mehrabad, and when we came down across the tracks, of course Pilgrim Pines wasn't there then, and we saw a bus coming from the direction of Arangaon village, and as we crossed the tracks and came down to the road, the bus slowly came to a stop just ahead of where Baba would cross the road. And the bus waited right there in the middle of the road, and Baba walked across slowly and just waited, and we came up and just stood back at a respectful distance. And everyone on the bus quietly and very gracefully climbed out of the bus, and they didn't rush up to Baba or anything, but they knelt there, took positions of great reverence, you know, and kneeling, looking lovingly at Baba, and Baba stood there, you know, looking so dynamic, his eyes flashing and radiating such love. And they all were, it was such a contrast to New York City. And this went on, this drama, for just a few moments, but it was exquisitely beautiful. And after a few moments, Baba smiled and said, which means, all right, now you can go on. And they all climbed back in the bus and went along. A very beautiful scene. Well, I meant to tell you that with Baba in Scarsdale, during that time when he was had his leg in the cast and all of that, naturally one would have a great deal of intimate contact with him. We had to help him hold his arms and his shoulders and lift his leg and, you know, have a lot of physical contact with him. And I felt that all through that time that I must not allow myself to be the devotee. I must try to be like a Mandali member if possible. And actually, Baba told Keith and I that we should consider ourselves as Mandali during that time. I didn't construe that to make us compare with the Eastern Mandali. But in other words, we were on his working crew. And I didn't want to allow myself to, you know, just have my mind blown and just stand there adoring Baba or anything like that. I had to be serviceable and anticipate his needs. And this was very difficult, to be around that ocean of love and try to keep your wits about you and even be efficient, you know. But in spite of everything, nothing could veil those eyes of infinite love and beauty. And when he would look at you, or the radiation, I mean, I had no idea what was happening, how much of it was penetrating through at the time, but it was really going very deep within. And you see, in his way with us, Baba never seemed to do anything in an outward way like, now I'm going to work with you or something like that. His work was going on very subtly and imperceptibly most of the time, and it is now too, I warn you. And so the heart was really getting a deep opening, and it was a part of the preparation for me for things to come. I didn't know it at the time. And there were things that were beautiful things that would happen along the way. I remember one day Charmaine and John and I had taken Baba to the hospital for an examination. And Charmaine went on ahead and came back and said we should come in. Before that, John and Baba and I sat out in the car, stood out there, John and I. And Baba sat in the car with the door open. And we carried along some 7-Up with us. So I'll show you how normal and human Baba is. So he said, let's have some 7-Up. And we'd forgotten an opener. And John struggled with the, you know, coins and things, he couldn't open it. Finally, he gave the bottle to me. And then it just occurred to me, I'd seen someone do this, so I thought, oh, I'll give it a try. Probably you've done this yourself. You go over against something that's solid and just catch the edge of the Coca-Cola bottle or whatever it is, 7-Up bottle, and give it a quick shove like that, and it pops off. So I did that, and I came back, and Baba looked at me in surprise, and he said, great. Incidentally, I still have that bottle. Nothing thrown away. And so when we did get upstairs, we had to wait in a hallway, and it was lunchtime, so Baba was comfortable in his wheelchair, and he didn't want anything to eat, but he sent Charmaine and John. There was a lunch room just around the corner, not very far, and I stayed alone with Baba. And then John came back, and Baba motioned to me that I could go and get some lunch. And Charmaine was still there, and I was getting lunch and sitting and eating with her all the time, wishing I had foregone all of that. I didn't want to be there. I wanted to be with Baba. And when I did get back to Baba, he looked at me so reproachfully. You've been neglecting me all this time. What have you been doing? Well, you know, this was one of Baba's ways, you know. He really drive the spear in. So what have you been doing? What's kept you? So I felt so badly about that. But then Baba motioned John and I to bring our chairs up close to him. No, closer, 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 till our knees were touching. And then people walking by and everything. Then Baba had us bow our heads, and here we sat with our three heads together the longest time. I suppose people went, what on earth's the matter with those three people? Our heads practically touching. I don't know what happened, but this was one of the things that Baba did. So, back at Scarsdale, I'll try to get some more stories in here. At that time, it happened 2 days. You may have read of the movie producer Gabriel Pascal, who managed to get the rights to produce the Bernard Shaw plays and all of that. He was a disciple of Baba. Baba called him his Black Panther, and he was of Hungarian origin, powerful built, and rather dark complexion, black hair, you know, and used to having his way in his world. And but underneath all of the things that he was involved in his world, he deeply loved Baba. And his dropping of his body was coming up pretty fast. He didn't know it. I didn't know it. Of course, Baba knew it. And at that time, he was very much concerned about going to India and making a picture, either Baba or Gandhi or something in India, in order to have something of Baba in the picture if possible. So I had gone into New York after him at least twice. And on this one afternoon, it was one of the most powerful afternoons I'd ever spent with Baba, because here was a scene of a real lover of God pouring out his heart to the Beloved in a veiled way. He was talking about the movie and scenes that he would put in the movie. He would kneel in front of Baba and express what he would have the character in this movie saying and doing. But all it was so intense. You know, when the vibes get very intense, if you can't stay with them, you fall asleep. And it was so intense, I had to stand up and kind of support myself against the sofa and behold this remarkable scene. And it was a scene, as I said, of one who deeply loved the Beloved, who was given this privilege. Actually, it was his last time with the Beloved, to really pour his heart out in this veiled way. You know, what a scene to be there to witness. Of course, he did drop his body, 2 years later, in 54. Never did get to India to do that. While we were with Baba in New York, we went to the Radio City Music Hall, to the zoo. Oh, let me tell you a story about going to the zoo. You know, Gene told you the story about going to Winterfell's that Sunday and having Baba throw fruit around and so on. Well, after that, we drove Baba out to the Bronx Zoo. And actually, Charmaine Deuce was supposed to push the wheelchair around the zoo. But a curious thing happened. Just as it came about time for her to start wheeling Baba, she decided that her shoelaces needed tightening. So she started to tighten one and it broke, and it made an awful mess of it. And then she started to tighten the other one and that broke. And they were both a mess. I don't know. But Baba, with a twinkle in his eye, motioned to Keith and I, come on, take over. So so we started wheeling Baba into the zoo. And there's some funny things that happened in the zoo on the way to the forum. But after a while, it began to sprinkle. And, we thought, well, I guess we'd better get back to the car. And then we discovered that we had not looked at the sign, parking lot signs, and none of us had any idea where the cars were. That was a funny situation. So Baba was in on it, and he'd say, let's go that way. So we would go that way, and it apparently led nowhere. And then Baba would say, well, Let's go that way. So then we, meantime, we're sprinkling, you know. We go that way, nothing happened. And we look at Baba, and Baba look at us and say, let's go that way. Of course, all the time he knew that Charmaine was coming after us and would find us. And so he made this game with us, you know. Here we were going in all directions. And of course, Charmaine did find us, and our lives were saved. And, see, I've told you about taking Baba on the plane. Well, let me shift over now to the 1954 then. Well, before, the last thing I want to say about 52 was one day I was talking to Dr. Nilu, and before breaking up our conversation, he said something to me that might have come straight from Baba's mouth the way it sounded and struck me. He said simply, come to India, with that Indian accent, you know, come to India. I think it was Baba planting the seed, because as I told earlier in one of these talks, in 1954 that actually did happen. Baba did send the invitation, and I was one of the lucky ones who did get to go. And this was the entitled, it was written up under the title of Three Incredible Weeks. And believe me, that was an understatement. Three incredible weeks with Baba in India. And as I've told before, the moment the invitation arrived, my trip began. It was a trip of the spirit, and it is a spirit from the heart. We made our journeys to Baba, and even along the way, I thought I'd never make a trip like that again, and I'd like to see some things along the way. And believe it or not, I'm sure that Baba made it possible, because although the trip was supposed to take 48 hours, it took twice that long, and I had stopovers in England and in Egypt, and saw a lot of things that one wouldn't ordinarily get to see and do. But I know it was Baba's gift. And but all along the way, well, one little incident in the Cairo Museum. After looking around the museum, finally came to the room where the Tutankhamun exhibit is. The sarcophagus, is that how you say it, of Tutankhamun is there. And they had an armed guard standing at the door, and he was a fierce-looking Egyptian with a curled-up mustache and well-armed, you know. And somehow our eyes locked, and we looked at each other for a few seconds, and I suppose he saw what was in my eyes, and he said, Allah. And I said, Allah. And I went my way with him. See, I don't know, maybe Baba wanted that contact, I don't know. So when we got to India, of course, Baba's people met us and took us up to, we thought we would be staying with different Baba lovers in the city of Ahmednagar, but to our great surprise and delight, we were taken straight to Mehrabad Hill, and we were going to stay in the upper room there, that sacred place where no one had stayed except Baba's secluded ladies. And when we got to the hill, we could look around a few moments before going to bed. And although Baba was at Mehrabad, some 18 miles away, his presence at Mehrabad Hill was so intense. It seemed to be radiating from everything, everywhere. And I was just amazed that, you know, this presence of Baba was so intense there. And finally I thought, it seems to be coming more from the building, you know, radiating from the building. And you know how a brick building will radiate the heat of the sun. Long after the sun has gone down, it still will be radiating that heat. Well, this building seemed to be radiating Baba's presence. And immediately I was reminding of that saying in the New Testament. It was a story about Jesus. They were out in the mountains, and some of his disciples were so exuberant, so joyful with being with him, that they were expressing themselves loudly and joyously. And some of the passers-by spoke to Jesus and said to him, "Why don't you quiet them down? They're making so much noise." And Jesus said, "If they didn't do that, the very stones would cry out." And I felt that this was what was happening on Meribah Hill. The very stones were crying out the presence of the Beloved. We actually saw Baba the next day for the first time. That was the day of the Mass, great last Mass Darshan program at Wadia Park. Many, you must have passed it many times on your way between the Pilgrim Center and Meherazad. And we didn't know about this ahead of time. We were taken there in station wagons, and there were some 18 Western men. And we were told that we were to sit on the platform with Baba. And during the course of that day, some 70 to 100,000 people came for Baba's darshan. And I won't go into the whole thing. But when Baba did arrive, he looked glorious and powerful and beautiful. And he just flashed us a glance, you know, and came forward to the front of the platform and prostrated himself in front of that vast multitude of people. And when he got up, he, using the board, said, "In order to save you the problem of the trouble of bowing down to me, I bow down to you." And he wanted people to feel that he was one of them and one with them. So he actually went out and sat with the women on one side first and then with the men, and came back and spelled this out. "In order to help you to understand and feel that I'm really one of you and one with you, I've come out to sit with you." And there were other things that went on, and finally the darshan program began. This turned out to be a day of divine love and action. This was a day that might have been taken out of the New Testament. It gave me an insight that I had never had into the wonder, the grandeur, the greatness of divine love in action. And Baba just sat there. It was a nice, comfortable chair for him to sit in, but he gave that up and took off his coat and rolled up his sleeves and went over to sit on the edge of the platform. And people were coming by him in great numbers, and they were funneled by a few hundred women, girls, and babes, and then a few hundred men and boys. And many of them brought, you know, gifts of fruit or flowers and garlands. Sweet-smelling flowers were draped around his neck till they'd get so full that they would have to be taken off and put here and put there. Before long, there were great piles of sweet-smelling and beautiful flowers there. And when the fruit was given to Baba, he would take it and touch it and hand it back to them for prasad. Well, I was sitting over on the side watching all of this, and not realizing that I was also being the recipient of that divine love which is being radiated. And during the course of the day, it became more and more apparent to me what it was and what a tremendous thing it was. You know, around Baba, we did not remain the same as we ordinarily are. Things change right away, and to be with him in a situation like that, inner centers open up, your sense of perception becomes very deep and penetrating, and your sense of awareness, and your heart center is opened up, perhaps other centers too, but you're able to fathom a little more than you would ordinarily. You're a different person. You could not remain static and as you seem to be now when you're in Baba's presence. And for me, it plunged me into a deep struggle to grasp the significance of what was taking place. That what was taking place outwardly was extremely beautiful, very, very colorful, and profoundly impressive. But I realized that something underneath is taking place that I couldn't quite grasp, you know. So I was plunged into this effort to try to grasp what it was. And of course it was love, divine love in action. And divine love is total significance, but we can never grasp, never fathom that significance. But we must try. This is our awakening, to try to fathom the significance of divine love and dare to plunge into it, dare to go into the ocean of love. Of course, it was easy there. One couldn't stay out. And I must say that in all of this, this was making a very deep impact upon me. I didn't know it at the time. It took many years for me to to finally realize what had taken place. But I came away from that in a state of deep, deep, deep love shock. Yeah. And that remained for years. I was able to do my work more or less automatically at home. I wasn't in a must-like state or anything like that. But somehow it created a deep within something that I struggled with for years. But during the course of that day, sometimes the men in the audience would, they couldn't restrain themselves. Baba was so magnetic, and people had to get to him, to touch his garment, his arm, any way they could get to touch him. And the men would rise up in a whole body and start to surge forward. And Baba would stand up and tell them to wait. And I said to myself, why are they doing that? Don't they realize they're getting Baba's love there? And I said, let me see what's happening. So I left the platform and went way around that whole pandal. And Baba's love was just as intense way out at the outer fringes as it was, you know, up near the platform. But they didn't realize it. But also, around Baba, you were never satisfied. It just made your longing for him more deep. You know, it just deepened that love longing. These men couldn't help themselves. They just had to get to him. And this happened two or three times. Of course, they finally did get to have their darshan, but I wondered what they would do when they came to him. Would they eat him up? You know. So Baba's love was so intense that day that when we got home, when I got home, Jean asked me, what happened on this particular day? And she said she felt Baba's love way back in Schenectady, New York, so intensely, you know. But not only on that day, but several other days during the course of that stay there. Baba only interrupted the darshan program briefly to go to a nearby field and sit with a group of some 20,000 poor people who were being given a free meal. And then he came back and continued his work. I didn't see him go to the restroom or anything. All day long, we Westerners, Baba motioned for us to go back to the retreat and have a lunch. I would have gladly foregone that to be with him. But when his one arm would give out, he'd shift to his other arm and back and forth all day long. Humanly, it seemed impossible to do such a thing. But all the time, this great flow of divine love was going on. In later years, I've come to feel that that was one of the periods where this exterior working was archetypal, and the format for a universal working which was going on right then and there. I think his love was going out and his work throughout the entire world, universes, how do I know how far, you know. There were lots of intimate things that happened around Baba too. During our time there, he was talking about dropping his body within a few months under very tragic and painful circumstances. And I didn't know what to think about this, whether it would really happen, whether we should take him seriously or not. But then consulting my heart and intuition, I felt that we should accept at face value what Baba said and feel the anguish and you know, respond in that way. And I did this. But in the meantime, I began to wonder, what will happen when Baba drops his body? What happens to our relationship with him? Do we lose it? Will we have no contact with him? Will he go off to some realm of bliss? What happens? And so this was one of the thoughts that was in my mind one day as we walked up Maribat Hill with him. And as we crested the hill, I looked over toward Baba, and he was, I mean, it was just walking over the hills of Galilee with the Christ. That was exactly what it was. You can't imagine what that does to one, to be in such a position, to see him, to be so near to him, and to know this is actually happening. And as often happened around Baba, when I glanced at him like that, a phrase from the New Testament came to my mind. I don't know why it was this one. Jesus saying to his disciples, you all say yes, yes, but you do not do the things I tell you, you know. And Baba shot me a quick, sharp glance. And within a couple minutes, we had walked around and into the big room, which is the museum now, where we sat with Baba every day. And but I sat way opposite Baba, not close to him, but I, of course, I was, that's only about 15 feet away. And Baba was using the board then, and he made some introductory comments on the board. And then without looking at me, he said, "I am the Ancient One, and when I drop my body, you all will come to see me. You all will love me more and come to see me as I really am." Ah. And so that's the answer to what happens when he drops his body. We won't lose him. We will come to see him as he really is. And this is for all of us, through love. And so while I'm kind of reeling from that, without looking at me at all, and a kind of a bland expression on his face, he says, "You all say yes, yes, but do not do." That was my thought out there. And I thought, how can you fathom this being? And again, with this same bland expression, he says, "I am so unfathomable that, that even I cannot fathom my infinite being." He would respond, sometimes he would respond to our thoughts, our feelings, our dilemmas. One day, he took us to Sikkori to visit the tomb of one of his masters, the late Upasani Maharaj. And it was a delightful day, and many things happened along the way. There's so many stories. You know, you didn't have to have something special happening. Something was happening all the time. Baba was always Baba, and something fantastic was happening just while you were walking, sitting, whatever you were doing with Baba. And anyway, we came to Sikkori, and we were shown around, spent a delightful afternoon there, and I want to read a little item, and this is something that happened. Reading it will be better than me telling it. Being with Baba was an experience so far removed from ordinary experiences that every moment with him seemed to be imbued with a divine significance, too profound to fathom or ever be fully explained. Sometimes while with him, one might become aware of an unfolding event which was so filled with meaning that one was astonished and almost overwhelmed to find oneself a part of what was happening. One of these situations took place in Sikkori on Monday, September 20th, 1954. Baba had taken us to Sikkori to visit the ashram of one of his masters, the late Upasani Maharaj. When it came time for lunch, Godavari Mai led Baba, his close Indian mandali, and the Westerners into a building, and the Indian mandali members sat cross-legged on the floor of the entrance room and were served food on a large green leaf, and they ate Indian fashion with their fingers. Meantime, Godavari Mai led Baba and the Westerners up a rather narrow, curving stairway into an upper room, which was especially prepared for us. Remember Jesus in the upper room? Tables were arranged, adjoining each other, almost in the shape of a U. Baba and Godavari Mai sat at the head table, while the Westerners were seated along the two extending tables, all on the outside of the U shape, so that all could see Baba and Godavari Mai. The nuns in yellow saris and the candidates in white saris stood along the walls in back of the Westerners. Baba looked exceptionally radiant and beautiful, but there was also a look of deep suffering in his eyes. A monk came in and, standing a few feet to Baba's left, looked adoringly at beloved Baba as he sang a sweet hymn of praise to him. Our eyes were drinking in the exquisite beauty of this scene. From the moment we had come into this upper room with Baba, I had been reminded of the scene of the Last Supper with Jesus. But now, while beholding this poignantly beautiful scene, I became intensely aware that in some mysterious way, I was in the midst of a living experience of Christ and the Last Supper. Here we were in the sublime simplicity, silently filling that room. And now let me read this again. Here we were in the upper room, and there he was in our midst, sitting there in sublime simplicity, silently filling that room and illuminating our inner beings with the unmistakable sweetness and wonder of his divinity. Well nigh overwhelmed with the awesome significance of this scene, I felt reluctant to actually start to eat some of the well-prepared and delicious food which was placed before us, being much more inclined to continue to behold and remain absorbed in this living page of a New Testament. Like others, however, I did eat some of the food, but Baba scarcely touched his food. Toward the end of the meal, Baba deftly changed the mood and atmosphere slightly by playfully tossing fruit to various ones around the room. At the end, Baba said, quote, "To find me, you have to lose yourself." But these are just words when spoken and heard. Losing oneself and finding oneself is for very few lovers who carry their lives in their sleeves. Upasani Maharaj's tomb. And as was the custom, we were to bow down and put our head on the tomb or kiss the tomb. And Baba did this first, and the Eastern Mandali followed, and then some of the Westerners were doing it. And meantime, I stood back there, and I discovered myself thinking, have I come, I must not have realized, you know, that, sorry to bow down to Upasani Maharaj's tomb, but I was thinking, have I come halfway around the world to bow down to strange gods? And it was my turn then. And Baba instantly, with a big smile on his face, came over to me and put one hand on my forehead and the other on my back and helped me to bend down. And I was bowing to his hand. Something to which I could not at that time possibly object. You see, how quickly he responded to my dilemma. And when I straightened up, he smiled at me, all right? And in order not to be conspicuous, he did the same thing to two or three others, you know. How quickly he responded to my dilemma. Well, this was happening all the time. Sometimes he would say something that seemed so irrelevant, you know, at the moment. But one person there would know what he meant. It wasn't just me, it might be someone else, you know. Someone would know what that meant. It was something they had been thinking, some wish, you know, something. And here's another little item that goes in that same time period. Sometimes, generally, after Baba had spent some time with us on the hill at Mehrabad, he would walk down the long winding road to where the car awaited him at Lower Mehrabad. There would always be one or two others with Baba, and one of them held an umbrella over Baba's head. Sometimes as Baba walked down the hill, he would pause to turn around and wave to us. I especially remember one day in particular. Baba had taken his leave of us, but we stayed outside the gate, looking after him with deep feelings of love and longing. He stopped some distance down the hill and waved to us. We returned his wave, after which most of the men went back to their quarters. We were out there by that pump, that little building just outside the gate at Upper Mehrabad, which is a pump. And we were waving to Baba. But after that first wave, most of the Western men went back in to the building. A few of us, however, lingered on to continue to watch Beloved. And we were so glad we remained, because to our surprise and delight, every 200 or 300 feet, Baba turned around to wave to us until he was way down the hill, almost out of sight. Each time we responded with a joyful surge of the spirit as we reached out to him with the fullness of our hearts. It seemed like such a spontaneous exchange of love. But I felt that Baba was showing us how constant his love is for us and how easy it is for us to reach out to him with our love and longing. One day over there, you know, the outside stairway that, you know, goes up to the second floor. You know, as I said earlier, being around Baba, the sense of love and longing became so sweet, so deep, so intense. It didn't diminish, it became deeper. And this one day, I'd gone upstairs for something, and I came out and stood on the platform at the top of those stairs, and I was watching Baba walk by down below. And this wave of longing was there. And Baba just stopped suddenly and looked up at me, is to death. Means you're doing the right thing. That love longing. I'm not going to be able to tell you everything, as I or otherwise I would be here all night, but I want to tell you some very choice things. One of them was our first interview with Baba went over there. This one day, Baba introduced the thing as rather humorously. He said, "This day I'm going to see each one of you and give you time to be with me for 15 minutes, I think it was. Even if it kills me," he says. He made it funny, you know. He said that when he met his master, he had lost his ego, the world, everything. But he said, "I retained my sense of humor. This is why you find me here with you like this." But we did get to see Baba individually. And Baba was in that little room that's used as a library now, the room that faces the hill. You know that room? And just Baba and Erich were in that little room. And of course, through Baba's grace, I know, of course, I'd been exposed to that whole day of his presence at the big darshan. And there was a day in between when we didn't see him. We were trying to assimilate some of that great impact of love. And the following day, I think it was, he came out and we had this opportunity to be with him alone, to greet him. And this was the kind of a day that each one of you would dream about, and I hope you will experience it as your own experience. And so I came in, and Baba made it possible for me to be there totally, in the spirit, as well as in the physical. And there he was, so beautiful, exquisitely beautiful, no way to describe his beauty. And when he would smile, he would seem to have such an ear-to-ear smile. And although he was under veils, there were times when he would seem to let some of them fall away and reveal so much more of his infinite beauty. And this was one of those occasions. And the sweetness of his love. And of course, I just, you know, came in and fell into his arms. And it was an experience of complete melting and bliss. And total bliss. And there were no obstacles. Everything had faded away. And there's nothing left but Baba's love. So after breaking from that, I had the funny experience of having Baba introduce me to Erich, who was reading the board. So as he read the board, Erich said, "Darwin, this is Erich." "This is Darwin, one of my dearest ones." And when Baba said that, pulled the rug right out from under me. And I, through great tears, I said, "How can you say that to Baba?" And he said, he became sober and said, "I do not humor you." And then I recalled that I'd brought a little package. Before coming to India, I thought, I should bring him a gift. "Well, what can you bring someone like Baba?" And after eliminating all kinds of thoughts, I settled on a nice white scarf. And it was wrapped neatly. But when I looked at it there, it looked so insignificant. So I said, I brought you just some little thing. And of course, Baba was aware of all my feelings. And he said, "You yourself are the best gift you could have brought. Baba's gift to me, or God's gift to me." And that really, that pulled everything out. And I was completely ruined after that. Completely ruined. But I hope you will feel that this is how he would treat you. That you are God's gift to him. Well, he took us to the village of Sakari, and we went through the village with him like Christ going through the villages of Galilee. And Malcolm Schloss and I would look at each other and we'd shake our heads and we'd say, "It's just incredible, it's incredible. You wouldn't believe it." And I recall so many poignant scenes of love and sweetness. People going into the houses of the poor, seeing him come to places where people would break coconuts at his feet, you know, the symbology of all of that, and bow down and kiss his feet. And I know going through the crowd one time, I noticed way off to the side there was a little old lady who had some flowers and a little tray and camphor lamp. obviously she wanted to come to him and perform the aarti. But there's no way she could get through the crowd, and I kept looking back and forth, and Baba didn't seem to see her. And we were going on and pressing on, and this poor woman had a look of desperation on her face. And finally Baba stopped and looked over her way and smiled and made a motion for everybody to move aside. He knew she was there, but he let her become anxious, you know, and long, and think she was going to miss out. But then he made way, and she came forward, and she couldn't believe her good fortune. And she was so nervous, and Baba, you know, motioned her to take her time. And she got her matches out to light the camphor lamp, and her matches fell on the ground, and she stooped down to get them. In the meantime, Baba was love dancing around, but she was so nervous, she looked up to see if Baba would still wait for her, and he looked lovingly at her, reassuring her that he would wait. And she finally did get her act together and lighted the match and lit this little camphor lamp and waved the tray in front of Baba and sang the aarti to him. Such a beautiful scene, so beautiful. And there were, you might say, the hovels of the poor. Baba would go in, we would go in with him, and they would prostrate themselves at Baba's feet. And so much love everywhere. And a little performance was arranged. Some of the village girls put on their best and did a little dance. They had prepared a place for Baba there. And afterwards, fruit was brought, and of course, as usual, Baba was throwing fruit in all directions, you know. Things like this. There, we had 3 weeks of this. 3 weeks of this. And you know, at first along, I thought, well, Baba will probably give us some profound spiritual discourses. And he did. And they're available. A little plug for the republished account of the 3 incredible weeks. It is available and it's worth getting. Many profound discourses. And we listened, but I think it was more or less going in one ear and out the other, because it was hard to concentrate on those things being in his presence. And I know that I discovered very shortly that something much greater was happening at a deeper level. And of course, before long, Baba stopped giving discourses. Sometimes music was played and so on. But I began to realize that whereas before there were blank walls in there or a fog or something, now there was a great vista. There was a great vista of beauty and wonder and great expansive view. And this vista was into the realm of Baba's love, into his being. He was taking us into his being. I don't know where our boundaries were anymore. They were lost, happily. And we were somehow taken into the beauty and wonder of the ocean of love that he is. And as I say, these clouds and fogs and walls were just dissolved within. And Baba did this without any ceremony, without having us practicing any yoga or anything at all. And we didn't even know that it was happening until we discovered these things. And it all led up to, I hate to bring this to a close, but I want to tell you this final little story that one afternoon we were sitting with Baba in this room. All of their props had fallen away. We'd had the last drink with Baba. We'd done so many things with Baba. Wonderful things. He'd taken us over and up Seclusion Hill. There's so many things. And this one afternoon, we were sitting there, sitting around Baba. It was a warm September afternoon. And you know how the windows are high up on the walls in that room. And there was a slight breeze sighing through. So we just sat there with Baba, and he was like an exquisite flower, and great waves of sweet love were welling forth from him. And we were being enveloped and dissolved in that love. And that room became love sanctuary. And in the midst of all of that, Baba smiled rather, you know, sweetly, and the wind made some sighing noises, so he pointed up to the window, you know, hear the noise. But we were so swept up in this atmosphere of divine love that none of us wanted to make any comments or do anything to break that mood. So Baba allowed it to continue, and it seemed to become more intense and more intense. And this was one of those occasions when, I know for my part, and I suppose the others had similar experiences, one looked at Baba, and again, one could see the veils begin to fall away, fall away. And one could look into his being, into those eyes of infinite love and beauty. And it was just, there was nothing, no personality that as we know it, as we see in people, ordinary people, no self at all, just an endless beyond of sweet, luminous love. That love was so great that we were literally overwhelmed. But finally, the afternoon session came to a close, and Baba, after embracing us, left. Excuse me. And everyone left the room except Sala Cotwell, whom some of you may know, and myself. We couldn't leave. We couldn't even move. And so I thought, this is so precious, though, such a treasure, that I have to try to get something down on paper. So this is what I wrote, The Song of the Wind. It has been developed as a song now. Listen to the song of the wind. Let it ever flow through your being. Let it ever remind, let me start again. Listen to the song of the wind. Let it ever remind you of my love. Let its soul-healing balm flow through your being wherever you are. And know that I have loved you as only God can love, and that I will love you thus throughout eternity. Know, beloved, that I have drawn, that you are mine forever, that I have drawn you from the realm of illusion to caress you with love divine. And this is the gift, the great gift, which awaits every one of you. Jai Mama. I'd be willing to talk more or answer questions, but I don't know what the time situation is. Time. Okay. Okay. Oh, let me read one little thing. Baba fulfills a secret wish. Sometimes around Baba, even a seemingly simple, very simple thing would become a wonderful experience. I recall one such occasion, which took place at the center in Myrtle Beach in 1956. Being naturally reserved, I was even more shy about expressing my inmost feelings when with Baba. And when away from him, I would sometimes fantasize some little thing I would like to do with Baba. On these occasions, it never occurred to me that Baba might be aware of my secret wish, much less provide for its fulfillment. This incident took place in front of the lagoon cabin. It happened so unexpectedly, but it was truly the right moment. I stood facing toward the lake. Apparently, there was no one around where I was just then. But hearing light footsteps behind me, I turned around, and there was Baba. His countenance was indescribably sweet and beautiful, his eyes divinely loving. In that instant, he somehow allowed all veils between us to vanish. I was dissolved into the essence of my total love for him. And as he held forth his arms to embrace me, he flashed to me that this was my opportunity to fulfill my secret longing. As I melted into the ocean of his sweet love, from the bottom of my heart I whispered into his ear the most precious word I knew, beloved. Jai Mama.